From New York, this is Democracy Now!
Remember what I said 4 years ago. I am your voice, and we will make America great again.
And America's heard. I believe the message should be loud and clear. It's time for Donald Trump to pack his bags and go home.
It's election day, but already history has been made. More than 100 million people have voted early, in person or absentee, shattering all records. That's nearly three quarters of the total vote in the 2016 election. Today, we look at how Latinx voters could play a key role in the battleground states of Florida, Texas, Arizona, and Pennsylvania. We'll speak to former Bernie Sanders advisor Chuck Rocha and the award-winning journalist Mariana Hossa. Then racial justice, reproductive rights, immigrant rights, ranked choice voting, just some of the ballot initiatives voted on across the country today.
Americans will also speak loudly this electoral cycle, down ballot, both in ballot measures and in candidate races. Americans will decide how we will respond to this moment of racial reckoning.
We'll speak to Ronald Newman of the American Civil Liberties Union. All that and more coming up. Welcome to Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, the Quarantine Report. I'm Amy Goodman. Today is Election Day. Over 100 million people have already voted, a record-shattering number that's more than two-thirds of the total votes cast in 2016, with tens of millions casting their ballots today. Election officials have warned full results could take days or possibly weeks to be verified due to the much higher number of mail-in ballots this year. But President Trump has decried post-election day ballot counting and threatened to go in with our lawyers, unquote. On Monday, Trump claimed on Twitter a Supreme Court ruling allowing Pennsylvania to count mail-in ballots postmarked by election day and received up to 3 days later will, quote, induce violence in the streets and rampant and unchecked cheating. Twitter labeled the tweet with a warning that its content might be misleading. Reports emerged Sunday Trump's preparing to claim victory tonight if he even appears to be ahead of Joe Biden. Biden told reporters in response the president is not going to steal this election. Trump and Biden made their final pitches over the last 24 hours, with Trump traveling to four pivotal states. Both candidates spoke at rallies in Pennsylvania, where Trump has already vowed to challenge results if they're not in his favor. This is Joe Biden addressing supporters in Pittsburgh.
Tomorrow, we can end the presidency that has divided this nation. Folks at home would know. Tomorrow, we can put an end to a presidency that has failed to protect the nation. Tomorrow, we can put an end to a presidency that has fanned the flames of hate across this nation, pouring gasoline on every racial incident in the country.
Biden also appeared in Ohio Monday. Trump campaigned in North Carolina, Pennsylvania, Wisconsin, and Michigan, where he attacked Democrats and reiterated many of his racist attacks against immigrants.
The open border lobbyists that killed our fellow citizens with illegal drugs and gangs and crime, they support Biden. The far left Democrats that ruined our public schools, depleted our inner cities, defunded our police, and demeaned your sacred faith and values, they support Biden. The anti-American radicals defaming our noble history, heritage, and heroes, they support Sleepy Joe Biden.
Meanwhile, non-scalable fencing was installed around the White House Monday in anticipation of possible protests. Many businesses in New York City, Washington, D.C., and other cities have boarded up their windows, while the government center in Minneapolis was also boarded up. A federal judge has thwarted an attempt by Texas Republicans to throw out nearly 127,000 drive-through votes already cast in Harris County. The 10 drive-through polling sites were set up to help Texans vote safely amidst the pandemic. The Republican plaintiffs are appealing the decision. Following the ruling, Harris County Clerk Chris Hollins announced late Monday 9 of the 10 polling drive-through places would be closed today in order to protect votes from any potential future challenges after the judge in the case said Election Day polling places must be inside buildings. Most of the drive-through sites were inside tents. Meanwhile, a judge in Nevada blocked a lawsuit by the Nevada Republican Party and the Trump campaign that sought to halt mail-in ballot counting in Clark County, Nevada's most populous county, home to Las Vegas. About 70% of Nevada's voters live in the county. Republicans claimed observers were unable to closely watch the counting of ballots, among other complaints. Deborah Birx, the White House Coronavirus Task Force coordinator, warned in a new report, quote, "We are entering the most concerning and most deadly phase of this pandemic." Dr. Birx slammed the government's response to the pandemic thus far, writing, quote, "This is not about lockdowns. It's about an aggressive, balanced approach that's not being implemented." Dr. Birx's remarks and recommendations in the internal report are in direct opposition to Trump's claims about the virus and his actions, including massive, maskless gatherings, which Birx warns against. She also notes testing is down and that the U.S. now has more county-level hotspots than at any other time. Nearly 9.3 million cases have been reported in the U.S., over 231,000 deaths, by far the highest totals anywhere in the world. In international pandemic news, Britain's preparing to go into a month-long second lockdown this week as many European countries grapple with a surge in cases. Prime Minister Boris Johnson said his government is extending its 80% wage subsidies for another month. In Afghanistan, gunmen stormed Kabul University Monday, killing at least 22 people. The Islamic State claimed responsibility for the attack, though some, including Afghanistan's vice president, said the Taliban were to blame. This is the latest deadly attack to hit Afghanistan as intra-Afghan peace talks continue in Qatar. On Tuesday, students came out to protest the ongoing violence.
I came here today to protest against all this injustice. We want to raise our voices to the world and say that we will never give up and that no matter how much they try to kill us, we will continue our studies.
In Austria, at least 4 people were killed and over a dozen injured after a series of shooting and stabbing attacks in 6 different locations in Vienna. Several people have been arrested, but authorities say they're unsure of how many suspects are still on the run. One suspect was killed by police, an unnamed 20-year-old man with North Macedonian and Austrian citizenship. This comes as Austria begins a partial lockdown today amidst a sharp rise in coronavirus cases. UN Human Rights Chief Michelle Bachelet said Monday, strikes on civilians in the ongoing Nagorno-Karabakh conflict could constitute war crimes and called again for a halt to attacks on towns, schools and hospitals. This comes after Armenia's leader asked Russia for military assistance after Azerbaijan's army pressed deeper into the disputed region of Nagorno-Karabakh over the weekend. The conflict has entered its 6th week with 3 failed ceasefire agreements. Armenia has also called for an investigation into the presence of foreign mercenaries after Armenian forces said they captured 2 fighters from Syria. Azerbaijan's president said Monday he's ready to end fighting if Armenia pledges to pull out of Nagorno-Karabakh. A day earlier, he warned his army is prepared to fight Armenia, quote, to the end. Back in the U.S., protests are continuing in Washington state over the police killing of 21-year-old Kevin Peterson Jr. in the city of Vancouver. Peterson was fatally shot by 3 Clark County Sheriff's deputies Thursday in a parking lot. According to reports, Peterson was sitting alone in his parked car when police approached. He got out and ran, though it's still unclear what happened just prior to his fatal shooting. Over the weekend, anti-police brutality protesters were confronted by right-wing counter-protesters. At least 7 people were arrested after a vigil Friday night. An independent investigation into Peterson's killing is underway. More information has emerged about a black family that was attacked in their car by a horde of Philadelphia police officers last week during protests over the police killing of Walter Wallace Jr. Video of the attack was caught by a nearby observer from their rooftop. An attorney for Rekia Young, the black mother who was driving the SUV at the time, confirms police busted all the car's windows, assaulted and arrested Young, pulled her 16-year-old nephew from the car, and grabbed her 2-year-old son, who suffered a bump on his head from the assault. The police union then posted a now-deleted photo of an officer holding the child on social media and claimed he was, quote, wandering around barefoot in an area experiencing complete lawlessness. The post also said, "We are the thin blue line, and we are the only thing standing between order and anarchy," unquote. The police union, the Fraternal Order of Police, have also published posts urging people to vote for Trump to preserve law and order. The U.S. Supreme Court Monday rejected a case against activist DeRay McKesson, sending it back to state courts for now. The lawsuit was filed by a police officer who was injured at a protest over the 2016 police killing of Alton Sterling in Baton Rouge, Louisiana. The unnamed officer was hit with a piece of concrete or rock allegedly thrown by a protester. The officer sued DeRay McKesson for damages because of his affiliation with Black Lives Matter, even though the identity of the alleged assailant is unknown. Kentucky Governor Andy Beshear vowed to take immediate corrective action Friday following reports Kentucky police used 3 Hitler quotes in a training slideshow and urged officers to be, quote, ruthless killers, unquote. One of the Hitler quotes was, "The very first essential for success is a perpetually constant and regular employment of violence," unquote. The slideshow was first reported by a high school newspaper. A police spokesperson said it was removed in 2013 and no longer in use. And Hurricane Uta is nearing Category 5 strength as it barrels towards Nicaragua. The hurricane's expected to cause catastrophic damage in the region, including flooding and nearly 3 feet of rain in other areas of Central America. It's the 28th named storm of the 2020 Atlantic hurricane season, which is on pace to break all records. And those are some of the headlines. This is Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, the Quarantine Report. I am Amy Goodman in New York. Juan Gonzalez joins us from his home in New Brunswick, New Jersey. Hi, Juan.
Hi, Amy, and welcome to all of our listeners and viewers across the country and around the world.
Well, people are voting across the United States for an election which is on pace to have the highest turnout rate in perhaps 150 years, percentage-wise. Nearly 100 million people have voted early. That's nearly three-quarters of the total 2016 vote count. But campaigns are still scrambling to get out the vote in key battleground states. On Monday, President Trump campaigned in North Carolina, Wisconsin, Michigan, and Pennsylvania. Meanwhile, Democratic presidential nominee, former Vice President Joe Biden, campaigned in Pennsylvania and Ohio. On this final day of the 2020 campaign, we look at how Latinx voters could play a key role in deciding the presidency and who controls the Senate. Many battleground states, including Florida, Texas and Arizona, have large Latinx communities. Many polls show Biden is not doing as well among Latinx voters as Hillary Clinton did in 2016. One recent poll in Florida showed a majority of Latinx voters supported Trump over Biden. We're joined now by two guests. Chuck Rocha was a campaign advisor to Bernie Sanders. He now runs the pro-Biden Westro PAC to mobilize the Latino voters. He's author of Tio Bernie, the inside story of how Bernie Sanders brought Latinos into the political revolution. And we're joined by Maria Hinojosa. She's an award-winning journalist, author of the new memoir, Once I Was You. a memoir of love and hate in a torn America. She's founder of Futuro Media, host of Latino USA, and co-host of the podcast In the Thick. Chuck Rocha, we begin with you. You're a numbers guy. Looking across the country, there was a Bloomberg report that came out this weekend that's saying Black and Latinx voters are not coming out in the numbers that Democratic Party hoped for. Can you talk specifically about the Latinx vote in Pennsylvania, in Florida, in Texas, where you are, in Arizona?
Well, thank you, and thank you, Amy. The Latino vote will be the single most important factor in this election. There's some truth on both sides of everything and all of the noise that you're hearing out there. There's one thing that's for sure, no matter where you are in America, that more Latinos will vote in this election than any time in the history of America. And already with early voting, you've had 2 million Latinos vote in Texas, 350,000 in Arizona, 1.4. All these numbers seem to drone together. But I'm not going to allow, and the Latino community is not going to allow, the party or either party to come step to us and say that we are underperforming. As I've been watching this election now for almost 2 years, working for Bernie, creating Nuestro PAC, talking and listening to amazing journalists like Maria and others who are doing work in our community, I'm seeing this unrest. And what's happening is Donald Trump is becoming the best get-out-the-vote operation that the Democrats have ever run. Are the Democrats doing a great job? They're doing an okay job. But there are so many people that are voting that are Latino who have no voting history. In Texas alone, almost 500,000 Latinos who've never voted before and have no voting history are showing up. That's not because of some astronomical program that the Democrats are running. That's because they're sick and tired of seeing what this president is doing to our community. Whether what we see in polling, is it around coronavirus? Is it around health care policy? Is it around jobs in the economy? It's all of those things wrapped together in a cabal of unrest and uneasiness in a community where we feel like nobody's really speaking for us. And we are yearning for somebody to come have that conversation, debate the issues, and show up with their hat in their hand and ask for our vote.
Chuck, I'm wondering if you could talk especially about Arizona, because to me, I think Arizona is more reflective of the enormous change in the Latino vote, especially given the fact that Arizona only a few years ago was the center of so much anti-immigrant reaction, the heyday of Joe Arpaio, the show me your papers law. And really, the Latinx vote there is probably going to be most decisive in moving that state into the Democratic column. Could you talk about what's happened there?
What you're seeing is an evolution in Arizona. And for all of you folks at home who may not live this life every day, Arizona is very different than Florida. It's very different than other states because it's like 80% Mexican-American. There's been the second and third generation of Latinos who've come of age in Arizona under a racist Joe Arpaio, under a racist law by the governor that said you have to show me your papers no matter who you are, even if you're a U.S. citizen, just because you may look brown. This is the attacks that I'm talking about that our community has lived through. And all of these young, woke, brown kids are now coming of age where they have self-organized without any help from Democrats or Republicans, for the most matter, and organized themselves, mainly around the Dreamer movement, the immigration movement, the Bernie Sanders movement, the social justice movement. And what you're seeing now, the fruits of those labors, there's amazing local Latino orgs like Lucha, who is a client of my firm, who've been working year in and year out in the state of Arizona. They don't just pop up 3 months before the election. They're there throughout the year, registering voters, helping people get access to health care, helping people fill out immigration papers. They're a part of the fabric of the community. And I've been preaching this since I was a little boy. If you show up there and you show up in the community and you show the community respect like Lucha and other community-based organizations, you start building the infrastructure of power. And that's what you're starting to see now because of the demographic growth in Arizona with these kids coming of age. And that's why you see a transformation of what's happening in Arizona in the electorate.
And Chuck, I want to follow that up, ask you about Pennsylvania. Everyone agrees that Pennsylvania is probably the most critical, a decisive state in this race. But there's very little attention been paid to the Latino vote in Pennsylvania. I want to read you some figures. These are the latest figures from the census, the 2019 U.S. Census estimates. Not talking about Philadelphia, but all of the small cities outside of Philadelphia and in central Pennsylvania. Reading, Pennsylvania, 66% Hispanic. Allentown, Pennsylvania, 52% Hispanic. Lebanon, 44%. Lancaster, 38%. Bethlehem, Pennsylvania, 28%. There's a whole, it's called the 222 Latino Corridor. All the cities up and down the state that are along Route 22 that have had enormous growth in their Latino population over the last 15, 20 years. Wondering what your sense of the impact of that vote, which is largely Puerto Rican, Dominican, and Mexican, will have on the results in Pennsylvania.
Oh, my brother, as we say in Texas, I'm picking up what you're putting down. I lived in Pennsylvania for 11 years, and I was the national political director of the Steelworkers Union. My son this morning texted me a picture of him and my twin four-year-old grandboys in Butler, Pennsylvania, going to vote. When I was in 1990 and starting with the steelworkers, I ran a steelworker for Congress and moved to Bethlehem and Allentown, Pennsylvania, where I discovered this huge Boricua neighborhoods and all of the radio stations like La Mega. So I have been one of the first people out there jumping up and down on the soapbox screaming about this. What happened in the last 4 or 5 years to exacerbate this even more was what you saw on the island of Puerto Rico. And with people fleeing Puerto Rico, people think that they all moved to Orlando. Well, over 200,000 of them moved in with their family members in that corridor that you're describing in eastern Pennsylvania. And because me and Nuestro PAC have seen no real investment in this community early, Nuestro PAC, my PAC, we spent over $1 million starting in July talking to Latinos. Now, many times we were the only ones there with some great organizations on the ground like Unidos Action Fund and a handful of others that have been doing the work there. But we've been diligently communicating in Spanish and English with this community because they have one thing in mind, and this is something that y'all talk about, Maria talks about all the time, is the difference between a Cuban voter and a Puerto Rican voter, even though they're both Caribbean Latinos. Puerto Ricans are way more apt not to like Donald Trump in any form or fashion and voted 60, 65, and 70% for a Democrat. So you need to go have a conversation, talk to them over a long period of time like Nuestro PAC did. We sent them 6 pieces of mail, radio commercials, digital commercials. We did the Bernie Sanders paid multi-level communication. But we were one of the only ones to do it. Imagine if they would have spent the amount of money that they spend in Philadelphia talking to white persuadable voters, which as of my last check was over $50 million. Compared to my little $1 million talking to Latinos. This is an overarching thing that we'll talk about after the election, but you need to treat Latinos like white persuadable voters, invest the same amount of money, and we will no longer have to accept the bare minimum when it comes to Latino turnout and their persuasion percentages.
We are talking to Chuck Rocha, founder of Nuestro PAC. He's going to stay with us. But when we come back, we're also joined by the award-winning journalist Maria Hinojosa. She's founder of Futuro Media and has a new book out, a magnificent memoir that's called Once I Was You. Stay with us. Dated by the Ramones. This is Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, the Quarantine Report. I'm Amy Goodman with Juan Gonzalez. Let's turn to two Florida voters discussing the Puerto Rican vote. We'll hear from Maria Reves, a Puerto Rican community organizer in Central Florida, but first to Bertisa Cabrera Morris, a Latinos for Trump board member.
I think that a lot of the Puerto Ricans from New York mostly had signed up as Democratic because that's where they came from. You will find that a lot of the Puerto Ricans here that might have signed up to be Democrats might vote Republican.
Puerto Ricans are not, you cannot put them in the same basket than Cuban Americans, right? Puerto Ricans are fairly progressive. They believe in systems of welfare. They believe that the poor should be taken care for. They believe that they should be health care for all. You know, the monster of communism and socialism doesn't scare Puerto Ricans, you know. I think that Puerto Ricans, they are a swing vote because when they come from the island, they don't belong to Republican or Democratic Party.
Two Puerto Rican voices from Florida. We are joined by Maria Hinojosa, a renowned journalist, award-winning journalist, and author of the new memoir, Once I Was You, as well as Chuck Rocha, who is a preeminent voting expert, particularly in the Latino community, president of Solidarity Strategies and founder of Nuestro PAC. Maria, welcome to Democracy Now! It's great to have you with us. As you listen to those two voices in Florida, you are spending your life right now, your podcast, your broadcast, talking about this election. Let's look at Florida right now.
Okay, specifically, you want me to talk about what I'm thinking about in terms
yes,
of Florida?
Yes, and relate it to these two voices we have just heard.
Okay.
Two voices, one for Trump, one for Biden.
Right.
Puerto Rican voices in Central Florida.
So, I know Bertica. I was speaking to Bertica 4 years ago. At that time, she was allegedly on the fence about Trump. Now she's solidly in Trump's land. The Trump administration, and later the campaign, has been playing what they always play. So this should not be a surprise. And frankly, for the Biden campaign to not be kind of prepared for it is surprising. So this notion about, like, the fear of socialism, more conservative, evangelical, anti-abortion, this thing that nobody really knows about unless you're from that, this conversation about religious liberty. Most people are like, religious liberty. We have religious liberty. Big issue for Latino evangelicals. So, Amy and Juan, what's been happening with the Trump folks is that they've been making those connections in those communities for a while. And so when Bertica makes those statements, it's true. And they are familiar with the Trump rhetoric. They respond to it because they respond to bully speak, and they respond to the fear. On the other hand, and this is where I got it wrong 4 years ago, I did think that the Puerto Rican vote in Central Florida was going to swing the entire state. And I failed to see that the anti-abortion Latino evangelical side of the Puerto Rican vote, which is just enough to be able to swing it, is more conservative. This time around, it's not clear. Even though the Trump administration has been making a lot of inroads in the campaign with Latino evangelicals, you know, they're also, what I was hearing in terms of my reporting, is that many Latinos and Latinas are like, están hasta aquí. This statement, estamos hasta aquí. We're up to our beyond our forehead. We cannot take this anymore. And what I'm focusing on in Central Florida, which I think Chuck is probably also geeking out about, is the youth vote. He talked about it in Arizona. It's the same kind of thing in Florida. Their parents may be voting for Trump, but will they? So that's where I'm thinking about Florida in particular.
Yeah, and Maria, if I could follow up on that, one of the points I've tried to make now for several months is that there are more than 2 million Latinos who turned 18 just since the last presidential election. And your emphasis on in terms of especially trying to get a sense of where the young vote is going, and clearly all of the polling has shown that especially when it comes to young people of all races and nationalities, there is a marked turn toward Biden and the Democrats versus Trump and the Republicans. But could you talk about what you found as you've been talking to young people around the country, young Latinos especially?
Right. So it's different than last year, than 4 years ago, in the sense that I think you remember, Juan and Amy, at the Democratic National Convention, the anti-Hillary, essentially Bernie wing of the party was so upset. And many Latinos and Latinas, my students, I remember, who were very much involved with Bernie, were very upset, to the point where many said, we're not going to be able to do this. I remember hearing them say, we're just not going to go. And it was like, yes, but you're throwing away a vote. And they were just like, I think that's different this time around. So that's one element. I think that we don't have the polling. I'm going to talk, Juan, about my own family right here in my home. You are in my home right now. My daughter, who is 22, 4 years ago, voted kind of like, yes, I like Hillary. She's fine. But, you know, Donald Trump is not going to win. She was wrong. Obviously, I knew that he had a very strong possibility of winning, as did probably you. This time around, she's been phone banking almost every weekend. She is the one who organized the family vote plan. On Sunday night, she walked up to me and she said, Mom, Texas is blue. And I'm like, it's 10 o'clock on a Sunday night in Harlem, New York City, and you're telling me Texas is blue? And I said, no, mijita, it's not. And she said, I'm repeating that to myself all the time as my mantra to make it come true. And I'm like, this is my New York City-raised Dominican-Mexican Harlemite daughter who's talking this way. She's not the only one. Latinas who I know who are working at the polls right now. So this is a part of the electorate that I don't think is being polled or tagged. I think Chuck knew how to connect with them, and he's absolutely right. If you connect with Latino, Latina voters, they will respond. And I'm also de la banda de Chuck Rocha, which says, you know what, you're really going to tell us again, with all due respect to the Bloomberg reporters, that we're not turning out? I'm not buying it this time around. Now, maybe I'm going to have to eat crow. Maybe I'm going to have to eat crow, but I do think that this generation of Latinos and Latinas who have felt these policies, mira, en la carne propia, with our skin, they are the ones who are saying, I'm absolutely voting. I'm voting, as you've heard people say online, I'm voting as if my life depended on it.
Chuck, I wanted to ask you, Latino Decisions, which does a lot of the polling for the National Association of Latino Elected and Appointed Officials, has been doing a tracking poll now for a couple of months. And their tracking poll shows of among Latinos around the country, and it shows that the number one issue for Latino voters is the coronavirus. And is the country's response to the coronavirus. Number two is healthcare. Number three is jobs. And then in fourth or fifth place, immigration. Your sense of what these issues reads, how they can be read in terms of how Latino voters will break today and have been breaking in this election.
Well, one, the polling is correct. I've done a ton of polling through the spring with Bernie and then in the summer doing focus groups and polling with Equis, Latino Decisions, and other folks, and that polling is spot on. I would push back a little bit, though, and say that you can have all the polling in the world, and you can be cute plus two, meaning that you can figure out all the matrix and analytics to talk about all these policy nuances. But if you don't actually step to the community and have a conversation, none of the policies or polling really matters. There's a lot of people showing up right now that are new voters who've never voted before. And as a practitioner, I'm one of the very few senior brown people who sit in major campaign meetings where the decisions are made. And what I'm telling all of you and all of your listeners, if you have no voting history, no matter what the color of your skin, no campaign is targeting you to get you out to vote. There are hundreds of thousands of young Latinos that nobody is talking to who are showing up because they're mad about their president trying to define this country as an angry, nasty place. The decisions that you're talking about in the Latino decision polling is what you see older Latinos reacting to when they call and ask them, and they're absolutely right. But unless a campaign in the early part of the summer when we were doing focus groups, we were talking to Latino infrequent voters. And what they were saying is, we don't like Donald Trump. We get that. Don't tell us nothing else about Donald Trump. But tell me something about Joe Biden. We don't know him. Our issues are corona, healthcare, jobs. What's he going to do to fix that? What's he going to do to make our lives better? They had not, as of June, July, and August and September, heard from any of the campaigns to say, tell us your plan. Tell us why we should vote for you, which is the larger problem that we're not going to fix today, but we're looking to fix as we go. And I've been chipping away at this with Bernie and other things to fix this as a totality. Our problem is not specifically around one issue. It's actually showing up there and saying, here's what we're going to do to fix that issue.
Maria Hinojosa, you have just come out with the book, Once I Was You, a memoir of love and hate in a torn America. It is a heart-rending book. It is a beautiful story of not only your life, and of course it is a memoir, but through you, the issue of, among other things, immigration, starting with your own family story. You grew up on the south side of Chicago, but you talk about almost having been separated from your mother when your family migrated from Mexico in the 1960s. Can you talk about what happened and this whole issue of child separation and how it plays out in the election, not only for the Latinx population, because you say that it's not only immigration the Latinx voting population cares about, but actually across this country?
Yeah. So, Amy, you know, I didn't fully understand my own story because this is what trauma looks like. You know, you think you know a story. I knew something had happened at the airport. What I didn't know was the level to which it escalated. So essentially, my dad, may he rest in peace, Dr. Raul Hinojosa, was recruited by the University of Chicago. He was a brilliant man. He helped to create the cochlear implant. That's how we end up in Chicago. He goes first. And a few months later, my mom and the four of us kids come by plane. So we had privilege. We came by plane from Mexico City to Dallas, Dallas to Chicago via airplane. And we had our green cards. I was a baby in my mother's arms. And what we thought was, what I had thought was some kind of a communication, you know, that happened. Actually, in the moment when we all lived through the babies and children that we heard screaming, the toddlers in those cages, we heard those voices in 2018. That's when my mother called me. My mother, already in her 80s, calls me crying. As we say in Mexican Spanish, a moco suelto. Le digo, mami, ¿qué pasa? No, mijita, es que that was almost me. I'm like, Mom, what are you talking about? No, mijita, es que that was almost you. The babies that have been taken, they almost did that to you. And I was like, what? So there are these policies, Amy. That's what I write about in Once I Was You, that on the books in the state of Texas allowed immigration agents to search our bodies to see if we were clean enough to come into the United States. Sound familiar? Body cavity searches that were happening potentially at the airport. That's why I was almost taken. The immigration agent says, your daughter has a rash, and so we're going to put her into quarantine. You can go ahead on to Chicago. And my mother has a mental breakdown right there and then, freaks out, calls on her privilege, starts screaming at the immigration agent, and that's why I'm in this country, because she lost it. And then that phone call, my mother said, I wasn't just a big mouth. She said, I went into a state of trauma. That's why I started screaming at him. So imagine my surprise, Amy, that I have a relationship. Now I understand why I do the work that I do and the way that I do it, which informs the work, Once I Was You. It is, yes, a memoir. Thank you for saying it was magnificent. Amy Goodman, once who was my boss. I love you. Thank you for saying that. You know, what I'm trying to say here is that it is not only my story. It is a policy, right? It is historical policy. The narrative is we love immigrants. The policies are not so much. So how does that apply to this moment? As I said, Chuck is exactly right. There is this entire generation, like let's say in Arizona, where I was exactly 10 years ago. Those were the young people who were activists who are now running for office and who are inspiring other young Latinos and Latinas to go to the polls. I'm not surprised that the issue of immigration is not number one. That's my job. That's my job as a journalist, is to be pushing that policy all the time. Because immigrants who are suffering from that actually cannot vote, right? It's the ones who vote who are thinking about these other issues. So that's my responsibility. And on the issue of immigration, we do not have a so-called immigration issue in this country. There is zero net immigration. Refugees are down to, what, 10,000, 15,000? It is basically at a zero. What this country has, and we shall see whether or not Joe Biden and Kamala Harris respond to this, is an international human rights crisis. We have women whose uteruses have been taken and their children have been taken from them. And this is not a one-time thing. It's been happening since they took indigenous children away, since they took the children of enslaved Africans away, since they took the children of Japanese Americans during the internment. We have been, this is part of our history, and only we, and possibly this politician, if he wins, can change that.
And Maria, speaking of this whole issue of tearing families apart, the latest report that the numbers of children held in detention, not just by the Trump administration, but also by the Obama administration, was much greater than had been officially recognized up until this point. Could you talk about how your reporting, your decision to get into journalism and the path that you took to get into journalism to report these untold stories?
You know, Juan, first of all, thank you to you, Juan. I've been shouting you out on every single interview. Everybody needs to read Juan and Joe Torres's book, News for All the People. Thank you, Juan. I understand why I do what I do. You help me understand that. I am part of Frederick Douglass, who is, you know, I'm lucky enough to be five blocks away from a statue of him right here in Harlem. He is the man who helped me to understand why I'm doing what I'm doing. You helped me to understand that. So the issue of immigration, Juan, you know, why is it that this country, on the one hand, is saying that it appreciates immigrants and, on the other hand, acts in total indifference to us? And you're exactly right. One of the hardest, not hard because I'm a journalist, I'm not a member of a party, I don't really care about party politics, but, you know, to have to actually pull out the research and just be like, whoa, the last president, I mean, yes, Ronald Reagan, but the last president who actually increased numbers was George H.W. Bush, former head of the CIA. He increased immigration numbers, increased TPS, increased refugees. So Bill Clinton was the one who created the wall. He started the wall. He ran on an anti-immigrant platform. So both, a pox on both of their houses. Now, this is where it gets tricky in terms of this moment, in terms of this election, because I think really for many Latinos and Latinas, that issue of immigration, they feel it again in la carne propia because it is their parents who cannot vote. And so that is something that is motivating them to get to the polls and speak out. I don't see that generation of being directly impacted by these human rights violations and these immigration policies sitting down and sitting on their hands. And you're right, Juan. I was the one who went into the detention camps in 2011 and pointed the finger at Barack Obama. And while we all love Barack, you know, he's amazing. The truth is that this is his Achilles heel. It will follow him and Joe Biden forever until they fully apologize for what they have done and say, and we're going to do better. It's not that hard, Juan, when you look at the level of dehumanization that we are all living with. Babies and children right now are being held in cages in the United States. They are not being fed. They are being psychologically tortured. There is torture occurring today, right now, on the backs of women, children, men, adolescents, simply because, like me, we were not born in this country. And it needs to stop.
Maria Hinojosa, we want to thank you so much for being with us. Award-winning journalist, author of the new memoir, Once I Was You, a memoir of love and hate in a torn America. Maria is founder of Futuro Media, host of Latino USA, and co-host of the podcast In the Thick. And thanks to Chuck Rocha, the president of Solidarity Strategies, founder of Nuestra PAC, the largest Latino-focused partisan super PAC in the country, author of Tio Bernie, the inside story of how Bernie Sanders brought Latinos into the political revolution. He was a senior advisor to Senator Bernie Sanders' presidential campaign. He will be joining us again tonight for our 3-hour special election coverage. We will be broadcasting tonight beginning at 9 p.m. Eastern Time. And you can go to democracynow.org, or you can see if your local TV or radio station is broadcasting Democracy Now!, as scores of stations are across the country. Coming up, we'll look at how racial justice, reproductive rights, immigrant rights, ranked choice voting, just some of the ballot initiatives being voted on across the country, in addition to presidents and vice presidents and senators and congresspeople. Stay with us. Turner Overdrive. This is Democracy Now!, the War and Peace Report, the Quarantine Report. I'm Amy Goodman with Juan Gonzalez. Yes, today is Election Day. All eyes are on the battle between President Trump and Joe Biden as people are heading to the polls across the country, but not for the first time. This is the final day of voting. In fact, over 100 million people, three-quarters of the total vote of 2016, have already voted. But down-ballot races and state ballot measures are also having major consequences for racial justice, immigration, ranked choice voting, reproductive rights. For more, we go to Washington, D.C., where we're joined by Ronald Newman, the National Political Director for the American Civil Liberties Union. Ronald, welcome to Democracy Now! It's great to have you with us. So many issues are on the ballot across the country, maybe not as much as in the past because of the pandemic and what it takes to get a ballot initiative on the ballot. But if you can talk about the significance of these and start off with the issue of racial justice, what you're following.
Absolutely. And thank you, Amy. Thank you, Juan, for having me this morning. We say all the time that the civil rights and civil liberties are determined up and down the ballot. And while there will inevitably be outsized attention on the presidential race, on Joe Biden, on Donald Trump, the issues and policies that affect people day in and day out are often determined at the bottom of the ballot, sometimes on the back of the ballot. And so we as an institution are very much engaged in those races, in those ballot measures. For instance, 805, a ballot measure in Oklahoma, will determine whether thousands of people, including lots of people of color, will be set free. Oklahoma, you know, has had among the highest incarceration rates in the nation for years, and this ballot measure will go a long way towards pulling back on extreme sentencing. In addition, if you think about Prop 16 out in California, we are trying to restore affirmative action in the context of education, hiring, and public contracting. And so minority-led businesses and women-led businesses have a real opportunity to make progress and to move forward. And so those issues come up all the time, not only in ballot measures, but also in down-ballot candidate races, the district attorney races, the sheriff races. These are the elections that have a real tangible effect on the lived experiences of people across the country.
And Ron, could you talk about Nebraska and vote for 428, why that is an issue of racial justice as well?
Absolutely. So in Nebraska, we will hopefully be able to celebrate a victory this evening and put an end to predatory payday lending Sadly, payday loans have been issued in Nebraska for years, and the interest rates on these loans average upwards of 400%. And so our ballot measure would end that and would put a cap on the APR associated with loans at 36%. And why does this matter? It matters because when you look at the numbers, you find that these types of predatory, abusive loans are disproportionately issued to people of color. And so every year, as Pew Research has reported, $28 million in fines and fees are pulled out of the pockets of Nebraskans, and not Nebraskans overall, because most Nebraskans don't use payday loans, but we're talking about the most vulnerable Nebraskans, including disproportionately people of color. And these payday lending shops set themselves up in communities of color at outsized rates, even when you adjust for income. And so as a matter of racial justice, we are fighting hard to end these abusive predatory loans.
And you've also put the spotlight on several county sheriff races in the South as, again, helping to end policies that especially target undocumented or immigrant workers in places like Charleston and in several counties in Georgia. Could you talk about those?
Yeah, so this work started a few years back. One of the elements of the Trump administration's anti-immigrant agenda has been pulling local police and local sheriff's deputies into their work. They've effectively been deputizing local police officers who are supposed to be protecting and serving their communities. They've deputized those police officers to be immigration agents. Often in cases where the populations in these towns, in these cities, in these counties don't know about it and would not approve of it. And so back in 2018, we engaged in a handful of sheriff's races in North Carolina, and the voters resoundingly chose challengers to the incumbents who ended those agreements with the federal government, with Immigration and Customs Enforcement. And we are again engaged in those battles this year. And so three to watch in particular are Cobb County, Georgia, Gwinnett County, Georgia, and Charleston County, South Carolina. In each and every one of those cases, there is a challenger to the incumbent who has pledged explicitly, who has committed explicitly to end those agreements on day one, so people within those communities can live in peace and security, knowing that the police officers who are supposed to be protecting and serving them are not, in effect, working as immigration agents trying to tear families apart.
I also wanted to ask you about ranked choice voting. Massachusetts and Alaska both have ballot initiatives about adopting ranked choice voting. This would allow voters to rank candidates in order of preference rather than casting a vote for a single candidate. The state of Maine has made history this year by becoming the first state to use ranked choice voting in a national election, and it could decide who wins the Senate race. The Republican, Senator Susan Collins, is in a tight race with Democrat Sarah Gideon. The Green Party candidate, Lisa Savage, is polling third. Under ranked choice voting, supporters of the Green candidate could pick the Democrat as their second option, giving the Democrat a potential boost in the second round of vote counting. So if you could talk about the significance of that, and then these two states, Montana and Alaska, what they're doing.
Yeah, so ranked choice voting has been an issue that we've tracked for a few years. The voters in Maine passed a ballot measure back in 2016 that established ranked choice voting within that state. And then we've spent the past few years fighting back and forth over whether those new rules would take effect. The ACLU itself was very engaged in 2018 when Republicans in the state sought to pull back or repeal that new voting regime. But ranked choice voting holds a significant degree of promise for making our democracy work better. At the heart of that reform is trying to ensure that election results reflect the will of the voters. Maine has struggled through several elections in which the winner of key races secured less than 50% of the vote, in many cases less than 40% of the vote, in circumstances where it was clear that most people preferred not to have that person take elected office. And so ranked choice voting helps to protect against that. In addition, it helps to protect against what you might call the spoiler effect. I think we've all been part of conversations where people have worried about that third party candidate, that Green Party candidate, siphoning votes away from another candidate. Through ranked choice voting, you can protect against that occurrence, because the second choice votes end up getting reallocated if no candidate gets over 50% of the vote. The last and final piece that advocates have talked about quite a bit in the context of ranked choice voting is the effect it might have on electoral discourse. If you're engaged in an election in which the second choice votes really matter, you might be less inclined to engage in negative campaigning and to make negative attacks against your competitors, because their voters are also important to you. So that range of benefits is what the state of Maine is after. And as you noted, it could have a significant effect in the Senate race. And other states like Massachusetts and Alaska are also considering taking that step, and following states like California and Minnesota that have adopted ranked choice voting in various places over the years.
Well, we want to thank you, Ron Newman, for joining us. Ronald Newman is the National Political Director for the American Civil Liberties Union. And we will be following all these ballot initiatives in our show, our special election show tonight, beginning at 9 Eastern time, and also in the coming days as this information comes out, as well as, of course, just doing our full election special tonight at 9 Eastern time. But we end the show with the acclaimed poet and activist Nikki Giovanni. She's out with a new collection of poems called Make Me Rain. In her poem Vote, Giovanni offers her thoughts on the importance of voting. This was filmed by The Meteor, a feminist collective of activists, journalists, and creators, for a daily Instagram series focusing on voting rights.
It's not a hug nor a mistletoe at Christmas. It's not a colored egg at Easter, nor a bunny hopping across the meadow. It's a vote saying you are a citizen, though it sometimes is chocolate or sometimes vanilla. It can be female or male. It is right or left. I can agree or disagree, but—and this is an important but—I am a citizen. I should be able to vote from prison. I should be able to vote from the battlefield. I should be able to vote when I get a driver's license. I should be able to vote when I purchase a gun. I must be able to vote if I'm in the hospital, if I'm in the old folks' home, if I'm needing a ride to the polling place. I am a citizen. I must be able to vote. Folks were lynched. Folks were shot. Folks' communities were gerrymandered. Folks who believed in the Constitution were lied to, burned out, bought and sold, because they agreed all men and women were created equal. Folks vote to make us free. It's not cookies nor cake, but it is the icing that is so sweet. Good for the folks, good for us. My country, 'tis of thee.
Acclaimed poet and activist and professor Nikki Giovanni reading her poem Vote, which is in her new collection, Make Me Rain. Special thanks to The Meteor, a feminist collective of activists. And a reminder, Democracy Now! Will air a 3-hour election night special tonight, from 9 p.m. to midnight. I'll be co-hosting with Juan Gonzalez and Nermeen Sheikh. You can watch it live at our website, democracynow.org. We'll be covering the results from the presidential election to congressional and state races, as well as ballot initiatives across the country. Democracy Now!'s Election Night special will feature interviews and perspectives that you won't hear anywhere else, including the voices of activists, analysts, grassroots leaders, discussing how the movements on the ground will go forward following this historic election, starting at 9 p.m. through midnight Eastern Time. And you can check your local station. I'm Amy Goodman with Juan Gonzalez. Special thanks to Julie Crosby.